airplane with your idea that wireless waves can be made to carry the human voice. You design and build your first crude carbon arc transmitter. And on a never-to-be-forgotten day of October 1907, you ask a young singer to come to your tiny laboratory. In great excitement, you show her a voice pickup phone, and you say, please try to sing through that.
I love you truly.
Yes, we found her. The first person in the world to have her voice broadcast by radio. From New York City, here is Madame Eugenia Farrar. You made the first broadcast in history, Mrs. Farrar. And who was the first radio announcer in history?
Dr. DeForest.
What?
He asked me to sing. And Mr. Edwards.
In announcing you to sing, he was the first announcer. That's right, he was, wasn't he?
And then a little while after that, he played the records.
Yes.
So he also became the first disc jockey.
Marconi did not conceive of broadcasting. DeForest completely turned around Marconi's invention and thought of it not as point-to-point, but as a technology that could transmit something from a particular point to many other points of reception. And DeForest begins broadcasting from a radio station on the northern portion of New York City. And here begins some of his major fights with Edwin Howard Armstrong.
It makes me very sad that his name isn't better known. I remember as a child, talking about him and saying, my uncle invented radio. And people, I couldn't put it any better than that. I didn't really know quite what he had invented. But nobody'd ever heard. They said, who is your uncle? I said, Edwin Howard Armstrong. Who? And even today, people say, Edwin Howard Armstrong. Who?
I believe that when history is written, all the history on this, Howard Armstrong should be remembered as greatest inventor of the 20th century.
He was the best development engineer I ever knew. He had the patience, the perseverance, the knowledge, the intuition that it took to make things come out the way he wanted them.
He was an extraordinary person. He exuded integrity and carried a sort of an aura of invention. He was a true genius, and there aren't very many in the world today.
Armstrong read the Boy's Book of Inventions that chronicled the exploits of men like Edison, Morse, and Marconi. After that, a friend said, he was all focused in one direction, wireless. He was not alone. There were already nearly 100 amateur wireless clubs in the country by then, and eager enthusiasts sat up far into the night, listening for faint signals from far away.
I put on a pair of earphones, and what came over was Morse code, and I was thrilled. My God, this is coming through the air. There's nothing around here making that noise. This is coming through the air. Beep, 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 beep. And from that moment, I was hooked on radio.
Strong set out to discover precisely how the DeForest audion tube worked. Something its inventor had never really understood, so that he could increase its power to amplify. In the middle of the night, on September 22nd, 1912, he succeeded. It was his first great discovery. He woke up his younger sister, Ethel, and forced her to listen to the deafening sounds pouring through his headphones.
Suddenly the door to my mother's room was thrown open and Uncle Howard burst into the room, waking my mother up. And he was dancing round and round the room with his box and he was saying, "I've done it, I've done it, I've done it."
Great amplification obtained at once, Armstrong noted in an account of his elegant invention. It was a simple idea. He called it regeneration. Armstrong's circuit fed the signal that came from a radio tube back through it again and again, each time increasing its power. He found he could do this as many as 20,000 times a second. Regeneration was the single most important advance in the history of radio. He patented his audio on receiving system in 1913. While Lee DeForest was trying to stay out of jail, Armstrong had put his Audion to work. And he made another discovery. When the feedback was increased beyond a critical level, the tube oscillated, creating its own radio waves. Armstrong had made it possible for DeForest's tube to transmit as well as receive. And it was now perfectly suited for voice and music, as well as program.
All of a sudden, everybody could hear these signals very, very much more easily and much greater distances. And of course, that brought the explosion of broadcast.
Who was this man? What was he? Others looked at radio and saw a gadget. David Sarnoff looked at radio and saw a household possession capable of enriching the lives of millions. David Sarnoff was so thoroughly American. No fiction celebrating the American dream could begin to approach his life.
Station EAQ, that's it.
Unlike DeForest and Armstrong, he was not any man. He was more than any man of his time, a corporate executive who understood the meaning and the impact of sound. When he was a very young man working for the Marconi Company, Sarnoff saw wireless communications as Marconi had seen it. Communication from one point or one person to another point or another person. What Sarnoff evolved was the idea of taking communication from one point and transmitting it to many points. In other words, from point to mast. And that was the origin of radio, of mass broadcasting, of one person talking to millions. He foresaw that clearly.
When I was a kid, somebody on the block said, "Have you heard there's a thing called radio, and you hear things through the air?" And I said, "Listen to this with incredulity. How could that be?" He said, "Harold Merchant down the block has a crystal set. Come." Was a Quaker Oats box with coils of wire around it. And it was wired up to a little galena. And this galena was Aladdin's lamp. And you rubbed it or you tickled it with a cat's whisker and in came the world.
Believe you me, I want to know how Jack and his friends get out of this one. You do too.
And I remember tuning in, I lived in Boston. Tuning in, my God, connected to New York. What a thrill that was.
WEAF, New York.
David Sarnoff was ahead of his time, but barely. Lee DeForest was already transmitting music and news bulletins every evening from his New York studio. And the news of Howard Armstrong's regenerative receiver had enraged him. Super Heterodyne. Armstrong Super Heterodyne captured radio waves of very high frequency and combined them with waves of a lower frequency to produce an entirely new wave. This new wave was then amplified several thousand times, vastly increasing the sensitivity of all receivers.
Sitting on my uncle's lap and putting my head up next to his, and he had his arm around me, and the headphones went across both of our heads. I remember having a piece in my ear and putting my head next to his and hearing bands play from far away, dance music that was not allowed in our family.
Speaking to you at this time from the Oval Room of the White House in Washington, D.C. The National Broadcasting Company is about to bring you an address by the Chief Executive of the Nation. Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
My friends, I want to talk for a few minutes with the people of the United States about banking. To talk with the comparatively few who understand the mechanics of banking, I want to tell you what has been done in the last few days.
Our president took such a dry subject as banking, Will Rogers said, and made everybody understand it, even the bankers.
It is your problem, my friends. Your problem no less than it is mine. Together, we cannot fail. Let us unite in banishing fear.
Roosevelt's fireside chats proved so effective that in many homes, FDR's picture was placed next to the receiver so that his listeners could see as well as hear their president.
This generation of Americans has a rendezvous with destiny.
American politics would never be the same again.
This great nation will endure.
Ladies and gentlemen of the radio audience,
well, howdy there, folks, and welcome to Melody Ranch with Gene Autry.
I'm back in the saddle again.
We got a radio then. It was a big floor-model Zenith radio. It was really a piece of architecture. It had columns, and it had grill work, and it had tremendous bass speakers that must have sat right on the floor or on the frame, because if you lay on the floor, as we did, if you lay on the floor on your belly, you could feel this sound come up through your stomach, and some men's voices on the radio would make your whole body tremble. I used to lie there and listen to it, late at night, listen to shows starting about 6:30 in the evening until we were packed off to bed. Just lie there in the dark, on the floor, curled up, listening to this immense radio. It had a tuning knob that was about as big as my fist, and you had to spin it a long time to get it from one end of the dial to the other. We lived in Minnesota, and it brought in stations in Salt Lake City, Pittsburgh, KDKA, and sometimes during the winter, Nashville, Tennessee.
Director of the National Association of Broadcasters, New York City. Gentlemen, what have you done to my child, the radio broadcast? You have debased this child, dressed him in rags of ragtime, tatters of jive and boogie-woogie.
Howard Armstrong didn't listen to the radio either because he was so annoyed by the static. He had perfected his third great discovery, frequency modulation.
Pictures are better.
Thank you.